In this video, we're going to look at central taste pathways. In a previous video, we looked at some peripheral mechanisms. I talked about how the surface of the tongue and other parts of the mouth are studded with little bumps. Those bumps contain structures called taste buds, and the taste buds themselves contain numerous taste receptor cells that come in a few different types. Some of them are involved in detecting specific qualities, like sweet, savory, bitter, sour, or salty qualities. There are also supporting cells, and there are stem cells that will regenerate the taste receptor cells because they turn over every 10 days or so. The taste receptor cells release transmitters onto the primary afferent neurons. That's what's shown at the bottom. Each taste bud is innervated by about 50 different neurons. Each of those neurons is receiving input from about 5 different taste receptor cells. And now what we're going to do is we're going to look at how the information received by these sensory neurons gets processed in the brain. The taste receptors in the different part of the mouth are innervated by different cranial nerves. For example, those in the front part of the tongue are innervated by the facial nerve, whereas those in the back of the pharynx are innervated by the vagus nerve. All of the taste sensory neurons terminate in a structure called the nucleus of the solitary tract, and as my cartoon shows, this is an elongate nucleus that spans the length of the medulla. The taste sensory neurons terminate in the rostral, the upper part of this nucleus. And in this region, there's a rough topographical map with those sensory neurons that innervate the front part of the tongue being more rostral than those coming from the back part of the tongue. Recall that the mouth also has a lot of somatosensory neurons. These are going to provide information about the texture and the weight and the temperature of the food. Those also terminate in the nucleus of the solitary tract. And the lower portion of the nucleus of the solitary tract receives innervation from mechanosensory and chemosensory neurons that innervate the gastrointestinal tract. And that information will also be important for modulating feeding behavior. We can record from the sensory neurons to see what their response characteristics look like. I'm going to show you data from one study where they recorded from the seventh cranial nerve in mice. What they did here was to take mice and then apply 6 different tastings to the tongue, one at a time, for 10 seconds each. And then they recorded the responses from individual neurons in that nerve. These studies have shown that the sensory neurons contain a mix of specialist neurons and generalist neurons, and I'll show you some examples. A number of neurons are what are called sugar-best neurons. This is an example. So here's a cell, and you can see that it's active to a number of different stimuli, but the best response is to sucrose. A different set of neurons respond best to other kinds of stimuli, so the M type will respond most strongly to umami, although they also respond to fat, and the E type or acid are responding to the hydrochloric acid and to the quinine. There are also N type that respond preferentially to salt, F type that respond preferentially to fat, and there are some neurons that are true generalists and will respond when there's any kind of tastant placed on the tongue. Similarly, electrophysiological recordings from the second-order neurons, the ones whose cell bodies lie in the nucleus of the solitary tract, have shown that many of them are broadly tuned and respond to a lot of different kinds of tastings, whereas some are narrowly tuned. For example, there are some cells that respond only to bitter stimuli. Now let's continue to look at the ascending pathways. So here we're going to look at various views through the brain, beginning with the medulla. This is the pons, and then there's also a frontal section through the brain at the level of the thalamus and the cortex. And we're interested in knowing what is the pathway that's going to allow us to consciously become aware of tastants in our brain. In humans, this involves a 3-neuron chain. The primary receptor cells are the ones that innervate the tongue and carry that information into the nucleus of the solitary tract. And I've got these 2 different views through the medulla just to remind you that the more anterior information is coming to the rostral part, whereas information from the back of the mouth is going a little bit deeper in the brain. The second-order neurons then project all the way up to the thalamus, and this is true for all of the sensory neurons, no matter what nerve they're in. These second-order neurons synapse on to third-order cells in the ventral posterior medial nucleus of the thalamus. You might have noticed that in my cartoon, I drew most of the neurons crossing at the level of the midbrain. This conclusion is based on studies on stroke patients who have lesions at various points along the pathway. And what they've found is that if there's a lesion above the level of the midbrain, then it tends to affect either the contralateral or, in many cases, both sides of the brains. For this reason, when I drew the projections from the third-order neurons, I've drawn them bilaterally. You can see that these neurons leave the thalamus and travel out to a particular part of the cortex called the insular cortex.
This is where we become conscious of different qualities of tastants. Those neurons themselves will project to other brain regions. One major target is the orbital frontal cortex. There's a site there that's often called the secondary gustatory cortex. Other targets include deeper brain structures such as the amygdala and the hypothalamus. What's pictured here is the taste pathway in humans. Other mammals, other vertebrates, will have variations on this. For example, in rodents, there is a four-neuron chain. The second-order neurons in the nucleus of the solitary tract project to a region of the pons called the parabranchial nucleus, where they terminate. Humans have a parabranchial nucleus. It lies right here. But in our system, our projections seem to pass through that nucleus and continue up straight to the thalamus. Here's a cartoon showing you the circuit in rodents, with the third-order neurons in the PBN then projecting to the thalamus, where fourth-order neurons would project to the insular cortex. Another species difference is that in some other primates, like monkeys, there are ipsilateral projections throughout the pathway. There doesn't seem to be that crossing over in the midbrain. The takeaway here is that as you read the literature, it's important for you to remember what the anatomy is in that particular species. I've switched to a side view of the human brains. In this surface view of the human brain, we can't actually see the primary gustatory cortex. It's tucked into the insula, that groove that lies between the temporal and frontal and parietal lobes. And to see it, we would have to pull back those lobes in order to expose the surface. The gustatory cortex would lie about here. It's close to the primary olfactory cortex, and it's also close to the somatosensory cortex. You might remember that the somatosensory cortex has a topographical map of the body surface, and the part of this structure that gets input from the mouth and tongue lies at the very base of the somatosensory cortex, right next to where the gustatory information would be processed. The close relationship between these three different cortices allows the gustatory cortex to integrate information from touch as well as from smell, and a number of the neurons in the primary gustatory cortex are multimodal. They'll respond not only to tastants, but also to smell and to texture. I mentioned the orbital frontal cortex, which serves as a secondary gustatory cortex. This part of the brain also contains many multimodal neurons. Well, I mentioned the topographical map of the body surface in the somatosensory cortex, and you might be wondering if there's a map of the tastants in the gustatory cortex. This question has been addressed both in animals using electrophysiology as well as in humans using imaging studies. Here's a study from humans in which they mapped six different tastants, bitter, salty, sour, umami, sweet, and carbon dioxide tastes in the brain. What they found is that different parts of the gustatory cortex do, on average, respond preferentially to one taste quality over another. But if you look at the lower line, where they map the responses from two different individuals, you can see that there's a lot of inter-individual variation. Look, for example, at the differences in responses elicited by the sour tastants in the two subjects. From these sorts of studies, we conclude that there probably is a map of tastants in animal brains, but it's more highly variable than what we see in some other sensory systems. Here's a mid-sagittal view, so I can map the other components of the taste pathway on here. Remember that we'd have the nucleus of the solitary tract in the midbrain. Neurons there would be projecting to the thalamus. The thalamus will project to the primary gustatory cortex. In the primary gustatory cortex, we extract information about the identity and the intensity of food. What are we eating, and how intense a flavor is it? The secondary gustatory cortex, the OFC, that's involved in the reward value of food. How palatable is it? And it's modulated by our internal state. We see different activity in neurons there depending on whether the animal is hungry or satiated. There are a number of other outputs from the primary gustatory cortex. There's feedback loops that feed back to the nucleus of the solitary tract. We also see output to the hypothalamus. The hypothalamus plays a key role in regulating the internal state. It can control the autonomic and endocrine systems to set our metabolic rate. It also has output to the cerebrum that can control food-seeking behavior. Yet another targets the limbic system. Now, we can't see the limbic system in a mid-sagittal view, so I've added the second image to show you where we would see those structures, the dark gray areas, the hippocampus. And here, at the front, I've highlighted the amygdala. That part of the brain is involved in positive and negative learning. For example, avoiding foods which made you sick and learning to like foods which gave you pleasure. Here I'm going to show you some functional brain imaging. In these images, the bright spots represent parts of the brain that are more active when a subject is given a sweet solution versus just plain water. And what you can see in the parasagittal view on the far left is the activation of the gustatory cortex in the anterior part of the insular cortex. The second view is a horizontal image, and here we can see the orbital frontal cortex lighting up. The images on the right are frontal sections taken at two different levels in the brain. We can see more of the insular cortex as well as some activation of the somatosensory cortex. And here's the amygdala, the part of the brain that's involved in learning aversive and pleasant stimuli. Our perception of taste is truly multimodal. What we eat is affected not only by the flavor, but also by the texture, by the smells, as well as visual input. So let me just show you how some of those other modalities converge onto this pathway. Here we're looking at the pathways for the taste receptors, sending the information to the gustatory cortex and then the amygdala, the orbitofrontal cortex, and the hypothalamus. But remember that there are also somatosensory receptors in our tongue. Those will send information to the NST. They project to the thalamus and from there to the primary somatosensory cortex, and output from there feeds into the primary gustatory cortex as well as the orbital frontal cortex. That's where we get the multimodality from it. Olfactory receptors also feed into this pathway. Receptors in our nose send their axons to the olfactory bulb. Those in turn project to the olfactory cortex, and that feeds into the amygdala and to the orbital frontal cortex. And there's even a role for vision. So that visual receptors, who send their information to the thalamus and from there to the visual cortex and higher visual processing brain centers, also converge onto the orbital frontal cortex. And if that weren't enough, our sense of taste is also modulated by the internal state of the animal. Our perception of taste is modulated by whether we're hungry or sated, and other factors such as whether we're happy or worried. I'll show you one study showing how the activity of neurons in the orbital frontal cortex can be influenced by both visual and olfactory information. In this study, the researchers quantified the activity in the orbital frontal cortex in response to an odor when it was paired with either the word cheddar cheese or body odor. The images show the results. There's much higher activity, more yellow, when the stimulus is paired with cheddar cheese than with the words body odor. I also want to talk about the role of the amygdala in learning to like or dislike foods. Activity in the gustatory pathway pictured here ties into another pathway in the brain, the reward pathways. A key player in this system is the nucleus accumbens. The nucleus accumbens plays a role in motivation and assigning salience, how important something is. It gets input from a region called the ventral tegmental area. We often hear about this in the context of addiction. A pleasurable substance, such as a drug, will lead to the release of dopamine from the VTA onto the nucleus accumbens so that the individual will assign more value to it. Well, it turns out that this reward pathway is modulated by the gustatory pathways. I already told you the gustatory cortex neurons project the orbital frontal cortex and the amygdala. And neurons in the amygdala send projections and modulate activity in both the nucleus accumbens and the ventral tegmental area. There's also input from the orbital frontal cortex to the nucleus accumbens. Remember that just in general, the frontal cortex is involved in planning and decision-making. And your decision of whether to have dessert at the end of a meal might depend on whether you've found that particular item pleasurable in the past. The overlap between these two circuits is an active research area, in part because it may help to explain some neural mechanisms of obesity. Well, in my example, I talked about something pleasurable, but this circuit's also involved in aversion. There's a well-established assay often used in rodents called conditioned taste aversion. This is illustrated in the picture. You can see that normally a mouse will consume a sweet solution, one with saccharin. However, if following ingesting that solution, the mouse is then injected with lithium chloride, something that leads to gastrointestinal distress, sickness, in the future when the mouse sees that same stimulus, it will avoid it. This figure shows the physiological correlates of this behavior. The gustatory cortex of the rodent is shown in yellow, and the researchers mapped out where they found cells responding to bitter, salty, sweet, and savory flavors. The bottom left panel, labeled control, shows us that there are portions of the gustatory cortex that normally respond to sweet, and those are distinct from those responding to bitter. However, following conditioned taste aversion, the pairing of the sweet with the bitter, the response in the animal is pulled back so that those two flavors appear to be activating the same regions in the gustatory cortex. This process can be reversed if after the conditioning, the animal then is presented repeatedly with the sweet solution and it's not paired with the sickness, then the map appears to return to normal. This has clinical applications in human cancer patients. During chemotherapy treatment, often the chemotherapy is paired with a food, let's say cherry jello. And those patients often develop an aversion, so simply seeing the cherry jello will lead to nausea. For that reason, people are interested in studying the cellular mechanisms underlying these circuits to see if it might be possible to develop therapies or drugs that might prevent the side effect.